All right, looks like it's 1 o'clock. So hello everyone. Welcome to this webinar. Today we're introducing the topic of religious literacy in our campuses. So my name is Laura Gallo. I work at Concordia University's Multi-Faith and Spirituality Center here in Montreal. And with me presenting today is Kate Johnson. Kate, would you like to introduce yourself?
Sure. So I'm Kate Johnson, and I'm the interfaith chaplain at Queen's University in Kingston.
And I'm just trying to pull up a picture of us. Here we are. So you can put a face to our voices. Okay, so Kate and I do similar workshops to this in our work on our respective campuses, but it's our first time presenting in a webinar format. So we thank you for your patience, as this is a new experience for us. And so just for your information, this webinar is being recorded, and the format is that we'll be talking, and I will be flipping through some slides. And your phones are muted, so we can't hear you, but you are encouraged to chat into the chat box, as hello, Tim, you just did. There is no sound, at least you can't hear yourself, but hopefully you can hear us. If you're having technical difficulties, though, feel free to type them in, and there's someone on the line who is hopefully able to help you. So there will be times when we'll ask explicitly for your participation, but you can feel free to ask questions along the way in the chat box. And as I said, if anyone's having technical difficulties, let us know. Maybe I'll just do a little test right now. If you can hear what's going on so far, can you just give us a little type, like a yes or a no? Okay. So it looks like it's working for most people. Thank you, everyone. Okay. So speaking of participation and speaking of literacy, we're going to kick things off with a little trivia. So pop quiz. The slides take a minute to flip. Pop quiz, everyone. What is the most common religious affiliation here in Canada? So take a minute to type in your answer. Okay, it's looking like most of us are in the religious studies field, or we work in chaplaincies. So most of the responses I'm seeing so far are Catholicism, Christianity, and you are exactly right. So the largest religious affiliation here in Canada is Roman Catholicism, with 2/3 of the population, followed by other Christian denominations, and of course all of these with varying levels of piety. Another one of my favorite questions to ask in this regard is, what is the fastest growing religion? And it's a bit of a trick question, because it's that the next biggest piece of the pie in white, which is actually no religion. So people who identify as having no religious affiliation is the fastest growing, with 23.9%, almost a quarter of the population. And then that's followed by other groups. We've got 3.2% identifying as Muslims, Jews are 1%, Hindus at, I think, 1.5%. And by the way, this graph is from Stats Canada in 2011, so it's slightly dated, but it's actually still fairly accurate. And this graph here is actually useful information for us to know, insofar as it's good to have a sense of the religious landscape of our country. But you may also find that this info is actually representative of the religious makeup of your campus.
Right.
Okay, next.
Great. So the concept that we're talking about today, religious literacy, is the notion that we know enough about religion that we can handle questions or particularly issues of accommodation or conflict on campus as they come to us. So most of us would know that the calendar certainly preferences people who practice some version of Christianity or cultural Christianity or who don't know where Christmas came from but sure like to have it off and spend it with their families. But as our society diversifies and our campuses internationalize, we have obligations to accommodate religious observation and then also need to navigate some of the personal complexities that these things bring up on our campuses. So we don't want this to be intimidating, and we don't actually think that it needs to be. Not all of us need to be religious studies majors in order to meet our obligations. What we need are curiosity, open-mindedness, and a willingness to learn. And that open-mindedness piece is particularly key. So we'll talk about the standards in Canada now, our charter obligations on the next slide. Oh, no, first we'll talk about why it matters. So we feel strongly that it helps to provide a framework for understanding each other, particularly when we exercise this open-mindedness. So we don't encounter somebody who's visibly religious or names a particular identification and then make all kinds of assumptions about that. But when we'll talk about how to be curious in a minute, this curiosity can really help us to understand each other and to meet a need when we encounter it. Obviously, if we are tactfully curious and open to other ideas, it's going to improve communication. Having a base level of literacy will really help to reduce conflict when conflicts arise as a result of religious practices, and often to parse out what is political and what is religious and how those things just are so complicated. And then finally, and many of us would argue most importantly, it supports student development. The research shows that having a spiritual or religious framework is very protective against many of the mental illnesses that we're so concerned about these days, but it also gives people a real grounding and sense of identity in times of transition, and it doesn't have to be a particular religious framework. This is true across the board that a spiritual or religious identity is very, very helpful in times of transition. In terms of our legal obligations, because this is a national seminar, we're going to point to the Canadian Charter of Rights and Freedoms. So most of us would know that we have freedom of religion under the initial sections of the Charter. So people have the right to practice, to believe what they want and to practice what they want as long as it doesn't harm other people. It's an interesting aspect that actually the decisions that have been made since the Charter also give us what is termed freedom from religion. So in Quebec, a particular business person acted against the Queen to say that he shouldn't be governed by the Lord's Day Act because he was not Christian, and that his conscience allowed him to run his business on Sundays. And so the law, the Lord's Day Act, was overturned in 1985, and that created the concept that we call freedom from religion in Canada. What I'm finding with the current demographic of students is that many of them are quite familiar with this freedom from religion and not as comfortable or familiar with our freedom of religion, because they don't remember the time when a particular religion dominated in quite the same way. the next slide. And then the next thing that we need to think about that balances off these charter concepts are the is the idea of secularism. And there are two kind of competing visions of secularism, and this always needs to be unpacked because people might be assuming that we're talking about closed when we're talking about open, or vice versa. So we'll talk first about closed secularism, which is more of the melting pot kind of philosophy when church and state are considered very separate and religion is thought to have absolutely no place in the public sphere. So there's no accommodation, there are no religious symbols, and people are meant to keep their faith as very much a private matter. In Canada, historically, and up until today, we've really worked on more of what we would, call an open model of secularism, which allows for a pluralism of expressions of religion and operates from the understanding that religion is an integral aspect of people's lives. This is important to who they are. It can't be parked at the boardroom or the classroom door. It's legit in our context, for example, to provide space for people to practice their religion, not in an overwhelming way, but in a way that makes them feel welcome and whole on campus. And it supports a certain level of religious accommodation in the public sphere as long as it doesn't interfere with other people's rights to freedom from religion. So we see this fought out around issues around public prayer, for example, and arguments about just how far universities should go to accommodate. So the next slide, please.
Okay. Let's check, how's everyone doing? Are you still awake? Because it's time for another trivia question. So what Canadian churches blessed same-sex unions even before gay marriage was legal in Canada? Go ahead and type your responses. Good. People are still with us.
I should just mention, Laura, I can't actually see the chat. Doesn't come up for me. So.
Oh, no.
Yeah, that's okay. You can read it, right?
Yes. Okay, so the responses I'm seeing so far are United Anglican, with a question mark, United Church, Unitarian Universalists, United Evangelical Lutheran Federation. Are we supposed to see the responses people type? Everyone could see the chat.
No.
We don't know.
This is Maddie here. No,
okay.
Only presenters can see the chat.
Okay, I this is Kate. I can't see it.
Yeah, okay. So it's just the presenters, so Laura and I can see it.
Oh, okay.
Oh, can we make it available to everyone?
We cannot. I'm sorry. It's part of the ReadyTalk platform.
Oh, okay. That's too bad. Okay. Well, I finally see that Joe has given us a correct response, which is the Metropolitan Church. I'm just going to go to my answer slide. So the Metropolitan Community Church and the Religious Society of Friends, or the Quakers, MCC, that's right, is this surprising to people out there? Yes, people are surprised. I was actually surprised myself. I thought it would have been the United Church as well. But I think, as Kate explained to me, I was confused with the fact that the United Church was ordaining gay ministers, or one of the first to do so.
Mm-hmm.
No, Richard Chambers says we think it's wrong. Don't know the Metropolitan Church, but Quakers don't surprise me. Okay, so Richard just wrote in to say that the United Church blessed same-sex unions in 1992.
Okay. And Quakers were doing it from the 80s.
And the Unitarians did too. Okay.
That makes sense, yeah.
Okay, so that's true and valid as well. Sorry about that. These, I guess, we were going with some of the first to do it, maybe. As you said, the Quakers did it in the 80s.
Yeah, so anyway,
yeah.
Nice to know there's lots of choices.
Yes,
that people
it is
have
nice to know.
Been in this forward-thinking on this issue for a long time, right?
Yes. Okay, thank you, everyone, for participating. I know it's hard to do a trivia like this and without everyone seeing the whole chat box. So we're gonna carry on from here to some case scenarios. So Kate just introduced some of the theory before this and laid some of the groundwork to religious literacy. So we've given you a working definition of what we mean by this, an understanding of different secular models. But how does this actually play out in our campuses and in our daily lives? So a great way to grapple with some of the issues are through case scenarios. So we've got a few situations that have actually occurred, and we've got one here that I'm going to present to you. And right after this, we're actually going to ask you to type in a scenario. Okay, so a student is washing his hands and feet in a standard sink in preparation for prayers multiple times each day. The bathroom has an air dryer, but no towel dispenser, so he's leaving a lot of water on the floor. He studies chemistry, and the nearest prayer room with ablution facilities is too far away for him to leave his experiments. People are complaining about the mess, and it's often a slip hazard. So what do you do?
Were we waiting for people's answers, or were we talking about what actually happened?
I think, Kate, you can go ahead and talk about what actually happened in this case.
Okay. Yeah, great. Thanks. So people, this is a scenario that happened here, and people were very concerned about sort of how to handle it and asked me to make sure that I consulted with all the right people. And I called the imam, and the imam said, tell the guy to get a towel. Really very, like, broke it down. There's no reason to fuss here. Yes, the guy needs to have the opportunity to wash up and do his thing, but there's absolutely no reason that you can't simply provide some towels and or ask him to bring a towel and tidy up after himself. Nothing untoward about that at all. And so I guess the point of this particular scenario is to make sure that we're not making things kind of more complicated or more sensitive than they need to be, and that a certain basic level of literacy can really help us to do that.
So, Kate, Joe has actually just typed in that, I guess, at his university, they were supposed to build a foot washing facility when the chapel was renovated, but they forgot, so they don't do anything. Water is everywhere. Only one sink, but in an area not used by many students.
They forgot.
They forgot.
Wow.
Curious.
That's a big forgetting.
Yeah.
I guess, you know, the standard stuff around signage and making sure that towels are available for people to wipe up with and so on. But one wonders if it shouldn't be revisiting that.
Mm-hmm. So, Joe, do you want to let us know, I guess, how you've handled that?
Yeah.
And perhaps while he's typing in, I'm going to go to the next slide, which is inviting you to let us know if you've encountered a situation on your campus. a situation where religious accommodation was an issue, or, you know, did something similar to this happen on your campus? So Joe has said that we've told the university that this needs to be addressed as planned, and so far there's no action, but everyone agrees. So it sounds like perhaps there could be action in the future on that. But in the meantime, is ablution still happening in that one sink? And is that okay with people? So I'm just going to give people another minute to write in their scenarios. And just to follow up with Joe, he said, yes, as far as we know, that people are using that sink. The community seems to understand. They're more concerned about all the crosses on the walls that weren't taken down.
Mm-hmm.
Okay, so Janine, I'm sorry if I'm mispronouncing your name, has written in a small scenario here. She says, our campus has one interfaith space, no official chapel, used by multiple groups whose bookings often overlap or conflict. So how do you accommodate all of the different needs?
So not every religious group would always need a specifically spiritual space in order to go ahead with their activity. So one would hope that they could be accommodated at other places in the university. So here we have something like 13 Christian clubs and then 4 Muslim clubs, 2 Jewish clubs, like quite a bit of diversity. And we actually don't have a sizable multi-faith space at all. And so that means they're using classrooms or multi-purpose rooms or gymnasiums or whatever, but that seems to work quite well. So that leaves me wondering, is there somebody on your campus who's responsible for sort of handling those bookings and negotiating any potential conflicts that come up?
So Janine, you could take your time answering that. We have a similar, it doesn't seem to be that much of an issue with the double bookings, but basically our rule of thumb here for booking our space is first come, first serve. So if you've got the dates for your events, you let us know and you fill out a booking form and then you've got it. And luckily we're also able to be open after hours, so perhaps this helps accommodate more people as well. Okay, Janine said, thanks, that's helpful. And so Janine will also have time at the end for questions, and we'll also have our email addresses up if you wanted to continue that discussion. But for now, I'm going to move things along and offer you another scenario, this time from the university side of things.
So the International Students Office is gearing up for a new semester, ready to receive thousands of new students from all over the world. You are welcoming all of them and encouraging them to get involved in university life. especially the International Students Office walking group, a great way to explore the city. A few days into September, several new students come back to the office unhappy. They are disappointed that all the walking tours are on Friday afternoons. Unfortunately, they're not able to come along due to religious observances at that time. You are completely overwhelmed with the beginning of the term, and this is the last thing you want to deal with. But what do you do?
Okay, so this is a situation that we've actually experienced before. The International Students Office is a student service department on campus. So as a student service department, we're here to serve students. And so ideally we can serve as many as possible and make our events as accessible as possible. So in this case, they actually handled it by moving the time of their walking group. But I also suggested that they don't make every single event on Friday afternoon, so that it could be accessible to students at different times of the week as well. And in this case, I also ended up doing a training with the student service department, because they were actually simply unaware of the fact that, you know, Muslims and Jews have holy days and holy times on Fridays, and they won't necessarily be able to participate. So it was an issue of knowledge, so they actually just didn't know that they were excluding two different religious groups. And also sometimes it's a simple tweak in the schedule. So they actually just moved it by half an hour so that people could come after prayer times, but also making it on another day as well lets people know that they have that option. Sometimes it's just giving people multiple options to choose from that can go great lengths in acknowledging their situations. Okay, it looks like some people are typing in comments, so I'm just going to wait a minute as they come in. If you have any questions about that, or if you still have a situation you'd like to let us know about, go ahead. So, Kate, do you think we should do one more scenario?
Sure. Yeah.
Oh, I'm just going to read one comment that came in about that. Carly has a suggestion that if you know any other students on campus who adhere to those faiths, that they could self-organize a walking tour for the international students. This provides a student perspective for them and takes the coordination work off your plate. That's a great idea as well. I think they actually have some students who actually facilitate the walking tours, which is great because it is so helpful to have a student's perspective. But at the same time, it's also important to let students know about setting times and dates and making the event as accessible as possible. Okay, I'm going to give you one more.
Are you going to read it or me?
Yeah, I'll read it.
Okay, great.
Okay, so an on-campus religious club asked to host an outreach event in the lobby or the main lounge of a large residence building on campus. So what do you say and how do you justify your decision? I imagine some of us have had this situation.
Mm-hmm.
So feel free to type in. And Kate, you can feel free to talk about your situation.
Mm-hmm. Do you want to wait until you see what people say?
Yeah, I can wait, or you can go ahead.
Okay, I'll go ahead. So okay. This is a scenario that we had here, and in this case, we said no, and the reason we said no was the event was specifically for the purpose of proselytization or recruitment, and we felt that the lobby of the residence building was a really inappropriate place. People should be able to walk in and out of the front door of their home without being interfered with religiously. And it just the tone of the event was not appropriate for that kind of, like, it's a public space, but it's a private space at the same time, if you see what I'm saying. So so we said no, but then when Laura and I were talking about this, we said it could depend on the tone of the event, right? Like, sometimes people want to do outreach by handing out sandwiches and just being kind, and kindness is really different than trying to engage people for recruitment purposes.
Was something else that was also interesting that came out in Kate and I's discussion about these different scenarios is that we actually had very different scenarios on each of our campuses. I'm working at a very large urban university. We've got nearly 50,000 students here at Concordia, and Kate's coming from a much smaller, rural university in Queens. So some of her scenarios are just things that I don't normally encounter here. So, for example, the ablution incident. And this may simply be because we're so large and there's maybe water on the floor all the time in our washrooms, or it's just the level of use is so high that we may not actually notice if one person is washing their hands or feet in a bathroom sink.
Yeah, and I think probably Kingston folk would want me to say rural is a strong word, but certainly it's not a community with a lot of religious diversity in the community itself, and so students can't just there is actually two synagogues within walking distance of the campus, but none of the mosques are within walking distance of the campus. In fact, the main mosque is a good 25-minute drive away with no public transit service to get there. And so that raises really different issues than when somebody can easily access and get themselves to the worship location of their choice.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, we seem to have really different, like the way chaplaincies have developed and the size of the campus and the diversity all seem to make huge differences in the kinds of things that we were encountering.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, and sometimes things just stick out more when you're a smaller population.
Absolutely.
In a smaller
yeah.
campus.
Yeah. Yeah, and the one story I had told you was actually from Acadia, where something was so obvious, but there was so little. That's such a small school, right? So again, by scale, things really stick out a lot more.
Yeah. Okay, so what can we get out of all of this? I'd like to offer some tips, I guess, for creating a religiously literate campus. So one issue that comes up time and again, seemingly no matter what campus you're on, is religious holy days and the need to accommodate them. So when planning an event, please consider these following ideas to increase the accessibility. And by doing so, just even if it's you're the only department who's doing this, you are being a model for religious literacy, and you're setting a precedent that it's okay to not hold an event because it's somebody's religious holy day. So consider the date when you're planning an event. Consider prayer times. think about if it's an event where there's physical contact between genders and the fact that some people may be uncomfortable with that, and consider dietary needs such as kosher, halal, vegetarian, and vegan. This is a big one, actually. So on our campus, which is pretty big, kosher food is available every day and fairly easily out of the halal offices. But on a lot of other campuses, it's not. So it's nice to acknowledge that. And also, we know that kosher and halal may be more expensive and it may be inconvenient to get. If you don't know if any Jews are even attending, you don't want to waste the food, for example. Something we've done in the past is we've made a note on the poster on somewhere on the event, like if you require kosher, just let us know 24 hours in advance. So this way we can actually order the food for them instead of providing it and then not knowing if it's going to get used. And then finally, use inclusive language to welcome students and staff who don't identify with a particular faith or who identify as atheist or agnostic. And sometimes also using the word spiritual or your spiritual path can have a big impact on students who identify more with that word. Okay, so more tips. So I hope one thing you're taking from this is that you don't need to be an expert, but hopefully you are willing to ask an expert. And that expert hopefully is your campus chaplain or your chaplaincy office. And if you don't have a chaplaincy office, then perhaps you have a diversity office or a human rights office who can help you with an issue you're having, or if you're not sure how holy a particular holy day is, we can help you figure that out. So consulting is always a great first step. It'll help you think about things you may have not been aware of. But I would also suggest that you be mindful of who you are asking. So are you always going to the most visibly religious person in your office to ask a question about religion? Maybe you don't need to be doing that every single time, as no one should be made to feel like they have to be your teacher all the time or a teacher for their whole tradition or culture. I would also suggest asking people about their personal practices rather than their personal beliefs. So not all people, this is for two reasons, not all people within a particular religion practice in the same way. And also practices are often what's at the crux of an issue. So for example, the ablution example we just used, the scenario, that was an issue of practice. So focusing on the practice, it keeps the issue accessible and tangible. We don't necessarily need to get into the beliefs and why they believe and that sort of thing. Okay, and finally, genuine, respectful curiosity will be acceptable to many, while demanding people defend their faith will be offensive to most. So curiosity is, as we've mentioned throughout this, the foundation of literacy. So keep an open mind and try your best to ask open questions. So for example, instead of asking someone a direct question like, do you believe in God, which leads to a yes or no answer and possibly also totally throws them off and puts them on the defensive, you could ask something a little more open-ended, such as, what are your spiritual practices? So this leaves room for them to expand and doesn't corner them into a yes or no response or put them on the defensive. Okay. We've got a final pop quiz for you. So which religious community in Burma is perpetrating genocide, and which religious groups are being persecuted? You can go ahead and type in your response. I'm impressed. Quite a few people are getting the answer.
Awesome.
So there is, I'll let you speak on this, Kate. Here is the answer.
Right. So it's the Buddhists in Burma or Myanmar who are perpetrating genocide and persecution there. The Muslims, the Rohingya people, are the primary victims, but many sects of Christianity and other non-Buddhists are also being persecuted and challenged there. And most of the refugees that are around the world from Burma these days are part of those minority religions and have been persecuted by the Buddhists, which typically in the West we stereotype as harmless and peaceful and all that kind of stuff.
So way to go, Alice Chen and Joe, for knowing that, and Elise as well.
I think the reason that one is has been helpful to me in my conversations with students is the sort of stereotype of either we were all not religious or all Buddhist. I hear that a lot. Then the world wouldn't have any problems. But the reality is we're all human. So regardless of our other identities, we're likely to create harm and good. So were you going to talk about the resources then?
Okay, I thought that was you.
Oh, sure, it could be. So again, we think it's really important that you ask your campus chaplain if you have one. There is a spiritual and religious pluralism community of practice on through Caucus, but also on Facebook, and that's a great place to ask questions and to, you know, about anything, and it's definitely the hive mind. There are people a part of that group from across the country.
I'm referring you to the Facebook group here, but if you want to actually officially join the community of practice and be involved with this group, you can email me, and my email address is coming up shortly.
So the multi-faith calendar, which is something that many universities use, and here at Queen's we have a campus-wide subscription to it, so our human rights office has it in their budget every year to provide access to this multi-faith calendar. People can consult it online, and it's also embedded in our university events calendar so that people have really easy ways to access the information. And then they also make a beautiful paper version, which you can hang in your office for easy reference. Very helpful in scheduling events. And it actually has information about the level of observance that is required so that you don't need to call an expert in order to know what you have to do for people that day. The standard is there. And then there's a really great pamphlet that was first developed at Dalhousie but has been Richard from the University of Toronto, who's on the call today, and other people have adapted it about aggressive religious recruitment on campus and how to deal with it. So we have a link there to the Dalhousie version of the pamphlet. And then in the Canadian context, what used to be called the Ontario Multifaith Council is now called the Canadian Multifaith Federation. And they have a great manual for just quick consultation about the sorts of requirements that people would have for religious observance or religious accommodation, generally when they're under the care of an institution like a prison or a hospital, but it can be a really handy thing to have around to just do a little fact checking and know what your obligations are. The Interfaith Youth Corps in the United States has great information on how to build healthy, pluralistic dialogue on your campus. And
they have great resources for programs, too.
Yeah, exactly.
Yeah.
Yeah. And then pluralism.org, same kind of notion at the bottom there.
So the last two are American resources, but they do have some great things that you find will you'll be able to apply to your campuses as well. The Pluralism website in particular has a bunch of case scenarios that you could use if you wanted to do a similar workshop or just something to discuss with your staff or to try out on students. Using these case scenarios can really help bring to light some of our own our holes in knowledge, our reactions, our assumptions. So they're a great resource.
And in most places, in most campuses where we're practicing some kind of interfaith dialogue and those kinds of conversations, students are saying that they're finding them really helpful to have a place where it's okay to be religious and to find out what they have in common with other people. It reinforces their sense of self, but in a really good way. And people learn a lot through those conversations. And it also is fantastically proactive ahead of potential conflicts on campus, where if group leaders or group members know each other a little bit, then they're much easier to work with when difficulty comes along.
So finally, feel free to contact us at our email addresses if you wanted to continue this conversation or if you have questions that come to you afterwards. You can let us know, or if you want to join our Spiritual and Religious Pluralism Community of Practice, which is a part of CACIS, please feel free to let me know. And the last thing I'm going to leave you with is actually this great graphic recording that was created at the CACIS 2015 conference, where the Spirituality and Religious Pluralism community I think first met officially.
Mm-hmm.
And somebody recorded, I guess, what came out of that meeting, and it's a really neat drawing, or I guess you could call it a drawing, of what went on, and it captures a lot probably what's going on your campus.
Many of us have found this is a good tool for speaking to our administrators about what we do as chaplains and what we bring to the university when the university has this kind of, or a college has this kind of support available, expertise available.
Okay. Well, thank you, everyone, for joining in on this webinar. I've now learned several valuable things about this chat window that only I can see.
Yes, and I thank you, too. And we would welcome your feedback about how helpful this is or things that we could add to it to make it more helpful in your particular context. So thanks.
10 minutes.